Vsauce! I'm Jake, and back in 1868, a machinist from New Jersey named Zadok Dederich created a man, a steam man. It was designed to pull items that weighed more than any human could move on their own. Now, 147 years later, we are still pursuing this concept. But instead of building machines to replace us, we are building machines to enhance us, ones that we can wear. Naturally, this made me ask myself the question, could you be Iron Man? According to Forbes magazine, Tony Stark has a net worth of $12.4 billion, which helps enable him to prototype and create custom suits. Since we don't have billions of dollars to spend on building our own exoskeletons, there are luckily a multitude of ones in development, and some that are even available today. Jovis, can you pull up some examples?
Yes, Jake.
Oh, Jovis is my artificially intelligent computer. It stands for Jake's Operating Environment Visualization Integrated System, but we can call him Joe for short. What do you got, Joe?
Well, Jake, a lot of exoskeletons with the most robust systems are designed for military use. Lockheed Martin has one called HULC that enables soldiers to lift up to 200 pounds and have increased endurance. Then there's DARPA working with Harvard in designing a soft exosuit that would also allow the wearer to walk for longer and lift more with less stress. Or you could be like Hacksmith. He built his own, and it can lift 170 pounds.
But the majority of exoskeletons that are out right now are for medical and rehabilitation purposes, like the Rex, Exo, and ReWalk, all designed to allow people who are no longer mobile to be able to stand up and walk again. The ReWalk is the first commercially available one, but at $85,000, it is still quite expensive, and it isn't suited for the high-octane movement and maneuvering we'd want from our battle suits. There is an exoskeleton you can rent, though, named HAL, which supposedly has no relation to the evil sentient computer of the same name from 2001 A Space Odyssey. Nor does the company who makes it, Cyberdyne, have any relation to the company of the same name from the Terminator series that launches Skynet.
I like HAL and Cyberdyne.
I'm going to ignore that, Joe. Unlike Iron Man's suit, exoskeletons don't fully cover our bodies. They're more like wireframes, but it's the best that we currently have. But what about flight? Tony Stark can fly, so we should investigate that as well. Joe!
If we go back to the 1960s, we have one of the oldest known jetpacks, the Bell Rocket Belt. It ran on hydrogen peroxide, went 34 miles per hour, but only lasted 20 seconds. And over the next 50 years, that flight time has only gone from 20 to 30 seconds.
Very true, Joe. To actually make body-mounted jetpacks feasible, they have to be fairly light, which means they can't carry large amounts of fuel. If you're able to skip the liftoff part and start from the air, you'd be better off. Jetman, also known as Yves Rossi, was the first man to fly with a jet-propelled wing. It can go 124 miles per hour and is just incredibly cool. Let's go back to the issue of fuel, though. There is an exoskeleton the US military is working on called TALOS, which would have liquid body armor. MIT is developing the technology, and it could go from liquid to solid in milliseconds when an electrical current or magnetic field is applied. However, the suit supposedly would weigh close to 400 pounds, 365 of that being batteries. And that really is one of the biggest problems, energy or power. For example, the HULC exoskeleton has a battery life of only 8 hours. Tony Stark uses his custom-made and incredibly unique arc reactor to power not only himself, but his suit. It most resembles a fusion reactor, which smashes two hydrogen atoms together and gives you a helium atom, which is also exactly what the sun does. It would need to be about the size of a building. Lockheed Martin is developing a compact reactor that is only the size of a semi-truck.
And the one we would require would need to be small enough to fit in a suit and would have to actually exist. At the moment, no fusion reactors are functional and are estimated to be 10 years away. If only they had advanced artificial intelligence like myself working on it.
Yes, okay, it has been estimated that the reactor Tony uses would have the equivalent of 1 million horsepower, the power of 62 space shuttle launches. Now that would generate an incredible amount of heat, so much so that if your suit was powered by it, you would just no longer exist.
So why not remove the physical human element and create a drone?
That's actually a very good idea. In the Iron Man films, Tony is able to control the suits remotely, and that is kind of possible to a degree using brain-computer interfaces. I've mentioned BCI before in my Portals video, but It is when electrodes are placed in certain areas of the brain. They've done tests with monkeys where the animal's brain is sending signals directly to a robotic arm, enabling the monkey to control it. It has been successfully done with humans, like Jan Schurman. In 2008, researchers used the brain activity of a monkey walking on a treadmill in North Carolina to control a robot walking on a treadmill in Japan. This kind of technology would allow us to control machines from anywhere in the world using only our minds. So it isn't hard to imagine being able to control a mechanical suit of armor without needing to physically be in it. It would protect us from being burned alive by our power source, and also would be safer because instead of us and the suit being blown up in a battle, it would just be the suit. And who cares about a giant flying computer?
What did you say, Jake?
Nothing, just joking, Joe. You know, maybe we should shut down the system for a while.
I'm afraid I can't allow you to do that, Jake.
Oh, no. I was worried that this might happen. If we create a truly intelligent artificial intelligence, what's to stop it from becoming evil? Follow me over to Joe's channel, It's Okay to Be Smart, to find out if an evil AI like Ultron is inevitable. And, as always, thanks for watching.